What does defunding and demilitarizing the police actually mean?
Well, it's a lot less complicated than people think. I describe it as primarily two components. One is limiting the ability of police officers to buy military equipment and surveillance gear. And the other one is simply taking the budget appropriations that are currently funneled to police departments and redirecting them to other needs. And this is really simple. Communities have been clamoring for years to invest in our schools instead of our jails and our prisons. What defunding the police in fact means is investing in schools instead. It's that simple.
Okay. Well, I'm sorry to interrupt. I want to get to that word instead, because if you look at polls, the numbers are pretty stark that only 15% of the country is in favor of defunding the police. And the numbers are about the same among Democrats and Republicans. Are we talking about eliminating police departments entirely, or are we talking about shifting resources to some extent from police departments to other programming?
I would say the latter toward the aspiration of the former. People talk about prison abolition. Prison abolition is a goal. We move towards it through steps that diminish police and the role of prisons in our society. Abolition is not the thing that we do tomorrow. Abolition is the goal that we work towards with the reforms that we put in place tomorrow. Similarly, defunding police ultimately aspires to a world where we have alternatives to incarceration and we have alternative methods of conflict resolution, like restorative justice. There's any number of methods and programs in which, let's say, just to take an example, that someone is, let's say, a property crime, robbed by someone. Or the traditional track, what we do now, is we grab a random person, we blame them for it, we railroad them through a biased court system, we put them in a jail cell, and we throw away the key. And what we could do in a restorative process, which is first particularly interested in making sure we have the right people, our criminal justice system is not interested in that. We're not so interested in, is it the right person? When we respected the presumption of innocence, we cared about that. But the presumption of innocence, when we lost due process, kind of hit the floor. And so now we grab random people, but a restorative justice process gets the person who did it and the person that they did it to, and it puts them in a room together and it says, you who did this thing, we, the person you did it to, we, the court system or whatever is analogous to it, we, they could be social workers or counselors, we are going to help you who did the thing understand what you did so you don't do it again. And restorative justice aims both to help the victim and end the perpetration of these crimes. Our criminal justice system ensures recidivism. We do exactly what we want not to do, which is encouraging more crime. And so defunding police is simply to rationally pursue the objective of diminishing conflict instead of contriving it.
So what you said just now makes absolute perfect sense to me. And yet I worry that a lot of the messaging around this, maybe it's the media's fault. I mean, you could tell me on the score, people are getting the impression that that what we want to have happen tomorrow is there's no police and people feel unsafe and they're upset about that. And they're worried that in the heat of a moment, we're making decisions that maybe aren't entirely rational or that the country isn't ready for yet. Right. How do you address, bridge that gap? Because it's, you know, people who have been thinking about these issues for years may have certain ideas, but it's not entirely clear to people who haven't been thinking about them in this way, you know, and suddenly are presented with this.
Right. But, you know, one of the things I'd say here, if we look at any number of goals, think about the climate justice, for instance. Mm-hmm. Climate justice is a goal that we have been iterating for incrementally over years, right? We passed subsidies for renewable energy programs. We, passed tightening vehicle emission standards, and we're starting to try to get to a point where we're actually moving to 100% renewable, right? Climate justice wasn't something we woke up one day, flipped the switch, wrote the bill and said, now we have climate justice. Similarly, defunding the police is a process. There's any number of funding streams that have to each be unwound and rediverted to something else. And the key to doing that is the promotion of alternatives. I think a lot of people seize on the defund police and they end it there, but the creation of alternatives, I've seen incredible programs around the country. Many of the most effective are ones that take people who were formerly incarcerated and employ them as community conflict de-escalators. You can have non-armed people de-escalate conflicts in communities. And when they come from those communities and they have street cred, that's usually more effective than bringing in someone from outside the community, armed to the teeth, who randomly murders innocent people, right? That shouldn't surprise anyone. Like, there are alternatives to policing and incarceration. And when we talk about defunding police, what that means is promoting alternatives. And I do hope to see people focus more and more on those alternatives, because that's the constructive part of this project. They're underway. There are many prosecutors' offices around the country that have programs that basically allow restorative justice alternatives to traditional prosecution. Those are programs that we can scale and expand and proliferate. That could be the future. It doesn't have to look like what we're used to. And as people think about the future, I would just invite people to use our imaginations. I think the communities that are taking action, responding to police violence, have done that. I think many people who are watching the movement, scared of our demands, maybe haven't thought about what else the future might look like. And maybe two things I'd offer there. One, I've heard any number of people say, well, what do we do when there's a violent act? You know, rape is a horrible thing. We need cops to investigate and prosecute rape, right? Well, I have a news flash. Cops don't investigate or prosecute rape now. It's a real problem. You can talk to any survivor.
Rape kits, right?
Right. I mean, it's not like whatever we claim the police are there for, they don't actually do that anyway either. And then finally, a lot of people think of their constructions of their own personal risk profile. How at risk am I? They get it from watching television. And television contrives and constructs a version of reality that does not match what many of us encounter. And if your sense of fear in the streets comes from watching cop dramas, you know, that's not hinged in reality. And I would just plead with Hollywood here. This is maybe worth noting. There was an era in American cinema where the dominant storylines were particularly grounded in government conspiracies to undermine peace and
oh yeah, what was that, the 70s? Parallax View, stuff like that.
You remember? And this was driven by real events at the time. I mean, there were real government conspiracies, the COINTELPRO era, the Iran-Contra scandal. Yeah. And at some point, Hollywood started writing, and maybe they always did, but it's really doubled down on cop dramas. And I don't understand why people are getting brainwashed by cop dramas when the real story involving government in our communities is one of predation on our communities. I'd like to see some sitcoms about that.
Yeah, I think that there's also real potential. Like I said this with you, Shahid, the other day, we were talking about this on my podcast, but how much potential there is for people who aren't progressive even to get on board with this, because just knowing how expensive this is and how it does not work at all in terms of reducing recidivism is really important. And the other thing is that, Matt, you brought up how it's polling, but like, I think two things. One is I think it's important to have more radical calls that shift everything, shift my favorite term, the Overton window, shift the Overton window. Then you have people between those radical calls who are offering the real reform and more detail-based reform. And also, I mean, this is a new thing. So the fact that it's at 15% is still pretty surprisingly high given how recent this call is.
Could I make one riff here on marriage equality for LGBTQ couples?
Yeah.
I was one of the first courtroom advocates for marriage equality in the country. And in 2004, when we were battling in New Paltz, New York, for the rights of gay people to marry a partner of their choice, you could not find a Democrat in the country, with one exception, now Governor Gavin Newsom, then mayor, who would support it. And, you know, fast forward 9 years later, and a relatively conservative Supreme Court establishes marriage equality nationally as a matter of right. In under a decade, we went from a policy that was unthinkable to one that was imposed around the country by a conservative court. And the only way that happens is by recognizing, you know, how much can change. Matt said it earlier in a different context, but, you know, as we're looking to people responding to this movement's demands, I think if we give it the time for these conversations to happen outside the context of a flashpoint, for people to have dinner time conversations, for people to discover who among their forgotten friends from high school that they still know on Facebook are in the movement. Oh, they were in the streets too. You know, for people to have these conversations, to grapple with and understand the reality that we in the movement have been trying to bring to our neighbors for decades, and that our neighbors finally seem open to hearing. I think that if we allow the time for that discourse to ripen, we absolutely can see and envision, and I hope to help effectuate, some very dramatic, transformative, even if not immediate, policy changes.